In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night, in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters scattered throughout the world to come together to watch and pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal Solemnity in this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, then we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death and living with him. Let us pray. O God, who through your Son bestowed upon the faithful the fire of your glory, sanctify this new fire, we pray, and grant that by these Paschal celebrations we may be so inflamed with heavenly desires that with minds made pure we may attain festivities of unending splendor. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Christ, yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, all time belongs to him and all ages. To him be glory and power through every age and forever. Amen.
Amen.
By his holy and glorious wounds, may Christ the Lord guard us and protect us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
May the light of Christ, rising in glory, dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds.
exult, let them exalt the hosts of heaven. Exult, let angel ministers of God exult. Let the trumpet of salvation sound aloud a mighty king's triumph. Be glad, let earth be glad, as glory floods her, ablaze with light from her eternal King. Let all corners of the earth be glad, knowing an end to gloom and darkness. Rejoice, let Mother Church also rejoice, arrayed with the lightning of his glory. Let this holy building shake with joy, filled with the mighty voices of the peoples. Therefore, dearest friends, standing in the awesome glory of this holy night, invoke with me, I ask you, the mercy of God Almighty, that he who has been pleased to number me, though unworthy, among the Levites, may pour into me his light unshadowed, that I may sing this candle's perfect praises. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, with ardent love of mind and heart, and with devoted service of our voice, to acclaim our God invisible, the Almighty Father, and Jesus Christ, our Lord, his Son, his only begotten, who for our sake paid Adam's debt to the eternal Father, and pouring out his own dear blood, wiped clean the record of our ancient sinfulness. These, then, are the feasts of Passover, in which is slain the Lamb, the one true Lamb, whose blood anoints the doorposts of believers. This is the night when once you led our forebears, Israel's children, from slavery in Egypt, and made them pass dry shod through the Red Sea. This is the night that with a pillar of fire banished the darkness of sin. This is the night that even now throughout the world sets Christian believers apart from worldly vices and from the gloom of sin, leading them to grace and joining them to his holy ones. This is the night when Christ broke the prison bars of death and rose victorious from the underworld. Our birth would have been no gain had we not been redeemed. Oh, wonder of your humble care for us, oh, love, oh, charity beyond all telling, to ransom a slave you gave away your son. Oh, truly necessary sin of Adam, destroyed completely by the death of Christ. Oh, happy fault that earned so great, so glorious a Redeemer. Oh, truly blessed night, worthy alone to know the time and hour when Christ rose from the underworld. This is the night of which it is written, the night shall be as bright as day. Dazzling is the night for me, and full of gladness. The sanctifying power of this night dispels wickedness, washes faults away, restores innocence to the fallen, and joy to mourners, drives out hatred, fosters concord, and brings down the mighty. On this your night of grace, O Holy Father, accept this candle, a solemn offering, the work of bees and of your servants' hands, an evening sacrifice of praise, this gift from your most holy church. But now we know the praises of this pillar, which glowing fire ignites for God's honor, a fire into many flames divided, yet never dimmed by shedding of its light, for it is fed by melting wax, drawn out by mother bees to build a torch so precious. Oh, truly blessed night, when things of heaven are wed to those of earth, and divine to the human. Therefore, Lord, we pray you that this candle, hallowed to the honor of your name, may persevere undimmed to overcome the darkness of this night. Receive it as a pleasing fragrance, and let it mingle with the lights of heaven. May this flame be found still burning by the morning star, the one morning star who never sets. Christ, your Son, who coming back from death's domain has shed his peaceful light on humanity, and lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters, now that we have begun our solemn vigil, let us listen with quiet hearts to the word of God. Let us meditate on how God in times past saved his people in these the last days and sent us his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this paschal work of salvation by the fullness of redemption.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, one day. And God said, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the firmament, and separated the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven. And there was evening, and there was morning, a second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind, upon the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, a third day. And God said, "Let there be light in the firmament of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be light in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, a fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the firmament of the heavens." So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, a fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, cattle and creeping things and beasts of the earth according to their kinds." And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and cattle according to their kinds, and everything that creeps upon the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." And God said, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. And God saw everything that he made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, a sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O God, who wonderfully created human nature and still more wonderfully redeemed it, grant us, we pray, to set our minds against the incitements of sin, that we may merit to attain eternal joys. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here am I." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering upon one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his ass, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the ass. I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father Abraham, "My father." And he said, "Here am I, my son." He said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. Then Abraham put forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here am I." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies, and by your descendants shall all the nations of the earth bless themselves, because you have obeyed my voice." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Preserve me, O God, I take refuge in you. Preserve me, O God, I take refuge in you. O Lord, it is you who are my portion and cup. It is you yourself who are my prize. I keep the Lord ever in my sight. Since he is at my right hand, I shall stand firm.
Preserve me, O God, I take refuge in you.
And so my heart rejoices, my soul is glad, even my body shall rest in safety. For you will not leave my soul among the dead, nor let your beloved know decay.
Preserve me, O God, I take refuge in you.
You will show me the path of life, the fullness of joy in your presence. At your right hand, happiness forever.
Preserve me, O God, I take refuge in you.
Let us pray. O God, supreme Father of the faithful, who increased the children of your promise by pouring out the grace of adoption throughout the whole world, and who through the Paschal mystery make your servant Abraham father of nations, as once you swore. Grant, we pray, that your peoples may enter worthily into the grace to which you call them. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the people of Israel may go on dry ground through the sea. And I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they shall go in after them. And I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his host, his chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh, his chariots and his horsemen." Then the angel of God, who went before the host of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from before them and stood behind them, coming between the host of Egypt and the host of Israel. And there was the cloud and the darkness. And the night passed without one coming near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, the waters being a wall to them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots and his horsemen. And in the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down upon the host of the Egyptians and discomfited the host of the Egyptians, clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots, and upon their horsemen." So Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its wonted flow when the morning appeared. And the Egyptians fled into it, and the Lord routed the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the host of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea. Not so much as one of them remained. But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw the great work which the Lord did against the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the people of Israel sang this song to the Lord.
Lord, if we come to
Let us pray. O God, whose ancient wonders remain undimmed in splendor even in our day, for what you once bestowed on a single people, freeing them from Pharaoh's persecution by the power of your right hand, now you bring about as the salvation of the nations through the waters of rebirth. Grant, we pray, that the whole world may become children of Abraham and inherit the dignity of Israel's birthright. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the prophet Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, when the house of Israel dwelt in their own land, they defiled it by their ways and their doings. Their conduct before me was like the uncleanness of a woman in her impurity. So I poured out my wrath upon them for the blood which they had shed in the land, for the idols with which they had defiled it. I scattered them among the nations, and they were dispersed through the countries. In accordance with their conduct and their deeds, I judged them. But when they came to the nations, wherever they came, they profaned my holy name, in that men said of them, "These are the people of the Lord," and yet they had to go out of his land. But I had concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel continued to be profaned among the nations to which they came. Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, it is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I am about to act, but for the sake of my holy name, which you have profaned among the nations to which you came. And I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, and which you have profaned among them. And the nations will know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when through you I vindicate my holiness before their eyes. For I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleannesses and from all your idols. I will cleanse you. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will take out of your flesh the heart of stone, and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and be careful to observe my ordinances. You shall dwell in the land which I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Like as the deer that
meridians of flowing waters, so longs my soul for God the living God. Like as the deer that yearns for flowing waters, so longs my soul for God the living God. Like the deer that yearns for flowing waters, so my soul is yearning for you, my God. My soul is thirsting for God, the God of my life. When can I enter and see the face of God? Like as the deer that yearns for flowing waters, so longs my soul for God the living God. These things will I remember as I pour out my soul, how I would lead the rejoicing crowd into the house of God. Send forth your light and your truth, let these be my guide. Let them bring me to your holy mountain, to the place where you dwell. Like as the deer that yearns for flowing waters, so longs my soul for God the living God. And I will come to the altar of God, the God of my joy. My Redeemer, I will thank you on the harp, O God, my God. Like as the deer that yearns for flowing waters, so longs my soul for God the living God.
Let us pray. O God of unchanging power and eternal light, look with favor on the wondrous mystery of the whole Church, and serenely accomplish the work of human salvation, which you planned from all eternity. May the whole world know and see that what was cast down is raised up, that what has become old is made new, and that all things are restored to integrity through Christ, just as by him they came into being, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Gloria in excelsis Deo. Let us pray. O God, who make this most sacred night radiant with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church a spirit of adoption, so that renewed in body and mind, we may render you undivided service. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brethren, all of us who have been baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead, by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the sinful body might be destroyed, and that we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For he who has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. For we know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia,
Come here,
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
When the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go in and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, they went to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the door of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone was rolled back, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him as he told you."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise.
It seems just a moment in time, but also an age, since we celebrated the Easter Vigil here at Blackfriars behind closed doors just under a year ago. The pandemic at that stage was new and had only started unfolding in this country a few short weeks previously. And yet, to see what had happened in China, the situation that has started to become serious in Italy, there was, as it were, the sound of galloping hooves approaching, distant at first, but then louder and more alarmingly present. Then we too, even in this priory, were in the midst of its ravages. By Easter last year, we were gathered online, faced by a still unfamiliar threat, looking for hope on this, the greatest of nights. Move forward a year, and the story of the pandemic is now painfully familiar. As time has unfolded, so has the sickness, the economic uncertainty, the isolation, and an ever-increasing death toll. Each life is precious, irreplaceable in its own right, and therefore each loss reverberates through networks of loved ones, of friends, and beyond. And added to this tragedy, there is the day-to-day cost to lives lived so abnormally. There is weariness with the status quo. There's the added pressure of days lived one very much like the next. There's the lack of spontaneity, variety, and color. It's not surprising, then, that fault lines appear in our lives under such conditions. It's a common experience in the present situation to find ourselves both stronger and weaker than we thought. Inasmuch as we have been able to adapt and manage, we may be surprised to find new vulnerabilities, patience, tolerance, and our ability to make and maintain peace are perhaps put to the test. Things can become fractious and difficult in relationships. Faith, perhaps, has been tested, even damaged. If this pandemic, with its forced asceticism, its stripping back of life to the bare essentials, has taught us anything, it's taught us this: we need God. That need isn't anything new, but we have to recognize that under normal conditions, our lives are bustling with things which distract us from this fundamental reality. Now, with fewer distractions, with greater pressures, and with our frailty exposed, we see not only a fuller picture of ourselves, but also see our greatest longing. We need God. I think we can go further. This need for God is not just something abstract, because we don't need a God who is simply a distant, factual reality, a God who is nothing more, perhaps, to us than a propositional statement. We need a God who is close to us, who identifies with us in our weakness, who shares our journey with us. We need a God who knows the contours of our lives intimately. We need a God who calls us his friends. And we have such a God in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. The liturgies that we have celebrated in these last days show us in the most beautiful way how it is that God comes close to us. He stoops down to wash our feet in the most intimate of gestures and inaugurates the memorial and representation of his great sacrifice. He takes upon himself the burdens of our hardships and our sins by enduring punishment and humiliation for us, by carrying our cross, and by being lifted up with arms outstretched to embrace us. His cry from the cross, "It is finished," sung with breaking voice at yesterday's Passion Liturgy, is not a whimper of defeat, but a cry of victory, shouted from the depth of God's love. In our present reality, we see the contours of our own struggles align with his passion, and we gladly, willingly accept his presence with us in our hardship. Even in the very depth of our being, where no person can reach us, we come to realize that we are not alone, and we hear his victory cry and long for it to take effect in our lives. Tonight, we have gathered as a Dominican community, gathered on your behalf around the Easter fire. We have lit the Paschal candle and processed into the church, looking, waiting for the return of the Lord from beyond the grave, where he has remained in the silence of death. And with the Paschal candle lit, it has been proclaimed in song that this is the night when Christ broke the prison bars of death and rose victorious from the underworld. The mysterious figure that we hear of in our gospel makes it plain to Mary Magdalene, to Mary the mother of Jesus, and to Salome that he has been raised. He is not here. Dear friends, the experience of hardship of these last 12 months is one shared by people across the world. But as we continue to grapple with these difficult times, we do so not against a backdrop of nihilism and despair, as though Good Friday was the end of our Lord's journey in failure. We grapple with these difficult times as Christians in the context of our faith. And specifically, we do so in the context of the grace flowing abundantly from our Lord's passion, death, and resurrection. The grace that he offers us, which comes to us through the gateway of baptism, which is our plunging into his death so that we might share his resurrection, makes it possible for that great longing for God to find ever more fulfillment in him, culminating in the all-fulfilling vision of him in eternity. Through grace, through his gift, we discover his love for us.
We find him as we search for him in our struggles and difficulties, because we discover this intimate closeness to us. Through grace, we open our minds and hearts as we speak to him, relate to him, ask of him, and receive from him in prayer. And as he lifts us up to share in the life of God. And of course, we partake whenever possible in the sacramental life, which renews and makes strong that life of grace within us. We need God. And that deepest longing finds a way forward for us tonight through his gift. For he has been raised from the dead.
Dear brothers and sisters, let us humbly beseech the Lord our God to bless this water he has created, which will be sprinkled upon us as a memorial of our baptism. May he graciously renew us, that we may remain faithful to the Spirit whom we have received. Lord our God, in your mercy be present to your people, who keep vigil on this most sacred night. And for us who recall the wondrous work of our creation and the still greater work of our redemption, graciously bless this water. For you created water to make the fields fruitful and to refresh and cleanse our bodies. You also made water the instrument of your mercy. For through water you freed your people from slavery and quenched their thirst in the desert. Through water, the prophets proclaimed the new covenant you were to enter upon with the human race. And last of all, through water, which Christ made holy in the Jordan, you have renewed our corrupted nature in the bath of regeneration. Therefore, may this water be for us a memorial of the baptism we have received, and grant that we may share in the gladness of our brothers and sisters who at Easter have received their baptism. Through Christ our Lord. Dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so, now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism, by which we once renounced Satan and his works, and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce Satan?
I do.
And all his works?
I do.
And all his empty show?
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
I do.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace, in Christ Jesus our Lord, for eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Except we ask, O Lord, the prayers of your people with the sacrificial offerings, that what has begun in the Paschal mysteries may, by the working of your power, bring us to the healing of eternity. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But on this night above all, to lord you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying he has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all who are gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred night of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelian, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damien, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for those whom you have been pleased to give the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, granting them forgiveness of all their sins. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, All glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall.
Hallelujah.
Let us pray. Pour out on us, O Lord, the spirit of your love, and in your kindness make those you have nourished by this paschal sacrament one in mind and heart, through Christ our Lord. There are several things to say this evening. First of all, I'd like to thank all those who have made these liturgies in this Easter Triduum possible, all those who have been involved in the preparation of the church, those who have acted as sacristans, those who have prepared the flowers, those who have served, those who have prepared the music and the liturgy in various ways, including, of course, our cantors and Sarah, our organist. I'd like to thank all of you for being here with us this evening. 1 year on, this is not the way that we would have liked to have celebrated our Easter liturgies, but nevertheless, in this time of pandemic, in this time of difficulty and struggle for so many, it's all the more important that we've been able to gather here, even virtually, to celebrate these great mysteries of our redemption. So on behalf of the community here, I would like to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for all the support, all the help, all the encouragement that you have provided for us in the last few days, weeks, and months. Without your support in various ways and prayers, we would not be able to continue. And at times when we are isolated, it is always so good to hear these notes of thanks and appreciation that you send for the little that we have been able to do for you. And on behalf of the community, I wish you all a happy and holy Easter. Know that we're praying for you, for your intentions, and praying for next time that we can be together at Easter, that we will have this church full as we like to have it, celebrate with you in the way that seems fitting. Please God. Bow down for the blessing. May Almighty God bless you through today's Easter solemnity, and in his compassion defend you from every assault of sin. Amen. And may he who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of his only begotten endow you with the prize of immortality. Amen. Now that the days of the Lord's Passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate the gladness of the Paschal feast come with Christ's help and exulting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Item is est, alleluia, alleluia.